Can you opine on what you're seeing in terms of diversity in the newsroom?
First of all, thank you. I'm from the big city of Denmark, South Carolina, where we have three stoplights and a blinking light. And so my mom and dad always told me the two most important words in the English language are the words thank you, and they're not nearly said enough. We are seeing more diversity in the newsroom at all levels. Decision makers, people who make the coffee, and everybody in between. And I think that is a value added. I think that's a plus. I think that's something that's very important. But we have to be cautious and ensure that with that diversity comes intentionality, and meaningfulness. When I speak to Fortune 500 companies, I oftentimes tell them that having a diversity, equity, and inclusion coordinator does no good if they sit a mile away from the CEO and only get, 10 minutes with you every 3 months, and then you just give them a little budget to go give money out to Black folk. I still think there's a huge gap in some of the stories that we are missing. And diversifying not just the newsroom, but diversifying the content we create, if that makes sense.
Oh, yeah.
Because we get caught up in some old dogmas of yesteryear, which is, for example, in my world of politics, we say things like working class voters or rural voters, like ain't no such thing as Black rural voters or Black working class voters, right? I'm like, where y'all grew up at? Like, that ain't where I'm from. And so I think we just have to continue to open our worldview and our lens to have stories, not only have diversity in the newsroom, but have diversity in our content as well.
Absolutely. And in terms of numbers, are you seeing people, you're seeing it increase? Like, we're losing people coming into public relations. Like, they come in for a year or two and then they opt out. Are you seeing that in the newsroom as well?
For a very long period of time, the only Black face you had on primetime news was Lester Holt. Then you had Lester Holt and Don Lemon. And then you had Lester Holt, Don Lemon, and Joyanne Reed. But you think about that and you realize that ain't a whole lot of folk when you combine cable and broadcast television and realize that when you just look at it as a plain, you think about all the hours that is prime time from I think it's 4 to 12 or 6 to 12 or whatever that number that quadrant may be, all those hours in a day, all those hours in a week, and you only have multiplied times all the stations, and you only have a small slither of individuals who carry that baton. And so I think we've made progress. My answer is we've made progress, but we still have yet a ways to go.
We have a lot of people on the phone today who are just starting in the profession. Do you have any advice for young people starting in their careers?
Yeah, and many times you forget your number one currency is relationships. And whenever you're covering a story or you are breaking a story or you are pitching a story, regardless of what that one interaction or success may be, realize that you will come back around to that individual again in your work. And it's important to build relationships. My toughest interview, this is a true story. October 12th of 2012, I was driving home from the University of South Carolina, Georgia game. I got pulled over and they cited me for DUI. And the case got dismissed. It was just an experience for me that I absolutely hated. We had a newsroom manager at our big station who held the story, got hold of the story and held it till sweeps weeks, which was weeks, if not months later, Black woman. And I thought we were friends. And so it made me feel some type of way about that relationship that I remember. But then I remember how Craig Melvin in 2014, I was running for lieutenant governor. He talked about that moment, me getting pulled over and going through that. And he said, now, how do voters respond when they look at you and ask, are you ready for prime time? It was a tough question, hard-hitting question. And it kind of came out of left field because I was there talking about being the first African American to run statewide for office in South Carolina or something like that. And I answered the question, and I had so much respect for Craig afterwards because he did his job. He did his job well. He did his job with dignity. He respected me. I respected him. And to this day, when he needs something, an exclusive or anything, I give it to him because He just treated me with that much respect. And two different Black folk treated me two different ways. And I think that you can do your job and do your job extremely well, but still treat people with that human dignity. Sometimes we forget.
We have people also who, we have a lot of journalists that transfer out of their career going into public relations.
Trying to make more money. That's what they're trying to do.
Hey, well, what advice would you have for people making that transition?
Find something to be really, really good at it, I think. No matter what you're doing. I mean, if you are transferring, moving from, you know, day in and day out journalism over to the PR world or whatever you may be doing, hone in on a skill. Don't be afraid. Know your value, know your worth. Because if you don't know your value and know your worth, then, I mean, Deborah, they drive down the market for the rest of us. Some of y'all out there taking $350 a month gigs when your market value is $1,500 or $2,500. So when Deborah go in and quote them, they look at you like you're crazy. I mean, and so I think that we have to do a better job of knowing our value and knowing our worth as well.
What I'd like to end with is just a conversation about resilience. So you know a little bit about that.
Yeah. I mean, life isn't about getting knocked down. I mean, we have that in common with the greatest. I mean, you know, some of the greatest minds I know, from Bill Clinton, Barack Obama, Newt Gingrich, Hillary Clinton. I mean, just brilliant minds, the way they think, not talking about their politics, but just the way their brains work. Bill Clinton's probably the smartest person I've ever met in my life. But regardless, with all that intellect or power or whatever it may be, LeBron James, whoever it is, Beyonce, I mean, you fall down.
That's right.
The strength is getting back up. And that's truly what amazing grace is, right? The definition of amazing grace is giving yourself that grace and him giving you that grace in order to get back up again. And we don't do that enough. And I would just stress to you guys, I've been through a lot the past few years. My daughter, my wife almost died during childbirth. My daughter got a liver transplant when she was 10 months old. She's doing very well now at 4 years old. I just lost my best friend a couple of weeks ago. At the age of 40 from a blood clot. I mean, you go through these things. And Deborah, I'll tell you this. I think it's Donnell Jones, but he sings a song, "I don't want to bore you waiting." You know, I every day just try to go out and continue to live a life that will make my parents proud and my children proud. And maybe one day we can all be free. And so I just say that you never know what other people are going through, but whatever you are going through, know that there's always darkness before the sun shines the brightest.
Thank you so much for your time. We do appreciate it. Yeah, you too. Bye-bye.